Hi guys, welcome to another edition of Tools and Techniques. In one of the previous videos, I had talked about how to run LLM locally and how to access that particular LLM through a open web UI as if you were working with a ChatGPT. And in another previous video, I had talked about a tool that I had created using the LLM to basically check whether I have a particular video in my YouTube history so that I can quickly respond back to the people who comment on my videos that whether a particular video exists or not. If you have not watched both of these videos, I suggest you can just watch it. But in this particular video, I mainly wanted to concentrate on telling how I created it and what is the whole concept behind RAG and how various things are connected together to make a working tool which is called as RAG. So without much further ado, let's get started. So all these various tools, that is ChatGPT, Gemma, Gemini and even Mistral, if you can think of them, they are nothing but brains. They are models. They are LLMs, and these basically take a question and give us a answer. Collectively, all these things are called as LLMs, that is large language models. But however, these large language models can only answer to the questions for which they are already trained. So sometimes what you typically do is you add another extra element to this particular LLM, and using that particular extra knowledge base, you can ask the questions and it will give you the answers. And this combined tool, which is LLM plus a knowledge base, a special local knowledge base that you have added to the LLM, is called as REG, that is RAG, that is Retrieval-Augmented Generator or Generation. Now, what we will do is we will try to understand how this RAG is actually created. I will give you the theoretical concepts first, and then I will actually show you a practical example through the code and explain how this has been created. We will try to understand what is this extra thing that we have added. This extra thing that we have added to the LLM is nothing but a vector store. Now the question is, how did we create that particular vector store? So let's start with something very simple. Imagine you have a sentence like, I love programming. So later point in time, if somebody asks a question, what do you love? It should basically be able to tell you love programming. That's what this is like. For a computer to understand and work with this sentence, we need to break it down into smaller pieces called as tokens. So when we take I love programming and turn it into something like this, it's like chopping up a big piece of text into a bit-sized pieces that computer can easily digest. That is nothing but tokenization. There are various ways of achieving the tokenization, something like whitespace tokenization, punctuation tokenization, rule-based tokenization, and character tokenization. These simple methods are generally free and can be implemented with basic programming logic. However, if you want to use some complex algorithms, you can do that. But then there are also some tools available like Natural Language Toolkit, Spacey, Hugging Face Transformers are also available. Some of these might be free, some of these might be paid tools. But depending upon whichever that you use, the overall idea pretty much remains the same, which is basically to create tokens out of the huge language text that you have. Each of these tools can help you handle tokenization in different ways, from very simple to sophisticated, depending upon your requirement. So once you have these tokens, the next step is to convert these tokens into vector. So think of vector as a numerical representation of our words or tokens. For example, token I can be represented as 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. This is just a dummy representation that I am using, but this is what vector is. And similarly, other tokens have their own vector representation. This process is called as vectorization. It's like translating our words into a language that machine can understand and work with. Just like tokenization, there are various tools available for vectorization as well. Some are free, others might cost a bit. Some of the very popular ones are Global Vector for word representation, Word2Vector, fast text. Then there are chat GPTs, OpenAI GPT transformers, Hugging Face transformers. They basically help you to convert your tokens into vectors, enabling more complex processing like similarity search and retrieval. After vectorizing all our tokens, we use these tokens to create a embedding. Think of embedding as a summary and a profile of all the tokens. It contains the semantic meaning of all the tokens. Finally, with these embeddings, we create a vector store. If you are wondering what is the relationship between vector store and a embedding, vector store contains the embeddings, which are used by the large language model to enhance its responses. I'll be showing you how in reality this all actually looks like in a moment. Well, if I want to use this LLM, create a embedding, create a vector store, to be able to work with a tool like OpenAI, it is going to cost me money because these tools are not free of cost. However small it is still going to cost money. And then the second part is all these things run on a cloud. You need to be connected to the internet. While learning, at least, I basically don't want to get into these kind of monetary commitments, at least not during the learning phase. So while I was creating this local RAG, my intention was I wanted to run these LLMs locally, and then I should be able to basically do the learning process free of cost. And the answer was basically the Ollama. What is Ollama? It is an open source project that simplifies running LLMs on your own computer. You can run it on Mac, Linux, and Windows. If you are wondering how to do this, I suggest you watch another video. So the advantage is basically it gives you accessibility. Learning and explanation can be done almost free of cost, and it provides all the customization that you want without bothering about how do I do it in the internet world. You can do it locally on your machine. Now, having understood how a RAG is created, now let me show you the code that actually implemented a RAG. This is the RAG that I am talking about. Let me show you what I am talking about. Pip environment shell and python 3 main.py. So this is the application that I am running. Ignore the initial parts. What I am interested in is basically concentrating on start talking to RAG. So let's directly enter this option 9 and then see what happens. If you are wondering what are all these things, I will get back to you in a moment later. So directly let me enter 9. So now it is loading the file and then asking you to ask the question. I can now say, do you have a video on Android? So the embedding that I have created is the knowledge base about all my videos that I have uploaded on YouTube. And now if I ask this particular question, it should be able to tell, do I have any videos on Android? So yes, I do. So give me the links of the videos on Android. It should be able to go through the knowledge base and give me the details. And in this case, it is a playlist. So yeah, so this is how it works. But the intention is not to teach you how the tool works. Now, this time I am basically talking about how I created this particular RAG. Well, there are two aspects here. One is prepare the data, and then second is run RAG on that data. So this one, we will check it later. I will give you a quick understanding of how I did this part. That is, how did I prepare the data? So if you go here, I have this JSON file, which contains data about videos from my YouTube channel. I wrote a Python script to download these multiple JSON files. And once I have these JSON files, I created a consolidated JSON file. This is an amalgamation of all these different JSON file into a one single JSON file. So once this was done, later point in time, I converted this JSON into a comma separated text file. So let me just show you here. This is the consolidated JSON file. It is a huge file. And then that is converted into a CSV file. It contains video title, that is decluttering remember and mutable state of by delegate. This is the whole title and this is the description. This is the thumbnail, the date you published and the URL. So all this was done through Python code. So once that part is done, then I have written talk via Ollama. This is where the actual RAG implementation starts. If you already know Python, a lot of this code should look very familiar to you, but I will try to make it as simple as possible. If you can see here, this is a class definition and these are various initializations and these are the various functions inside this particular class. So let me just start with the very first thing. What is it that the first function is doing? So the very first thing that we are doing here is load the data from the file. That is what this particular function load data from file does. So whatever the path that you give, it is nothing but your consolidated TXT file containing the comma separated values. It loads that particular data. And then the second part is it will be a very huge text file. So to make it a little bit easy in terms of the performance, what you have to do is split it. Split the content from the file. So that is what this particular thing is doing. It is basically splitting it into a chunks of 500. I am using some of these tools, frameworks to do it, but that's what this is all about. After that, there is this function called as create vector from data. But if you have a look at the internal implementation, it is using embeddings and then it is creating a vector store. So once again, what this particular create vector from data is doing is it is creating the embeddings. And once you have the embedding, out of that, you are creating the vector store. Now to create these embeddings, I am using some of the models, mnemonic, embed text. There are some other advanced models like BERT. You can get these things, download these things. How to work with these things is beyond the scope of this particular video, but you will get a very basic idea that I am creating a embedding here. I am using chroma.fromDocuments, creating a vector store, and I am returning that particular vector store. The next part is initialize LLM with vector store. That is what this function initialize qchain is doing. So it takes the vector store from the file and then initializes, sends it to Ollama. And once that is there, you are interacting with the Ollama, which is running locally at this particular local host. That is start talking to Ollama. And with that, we are pretty much done with the implementation of our RAG. And you can see that here I am passing the path of the file. And after that, I am just sending this particular question to my LLM. And this LLM is configured with this particular path and it has all these various functions. And this ask question gets repeatedly called again and again with whatever the question that you are passing. And that is how this thing works. If you ask any generic question, say, why is sky blue? It complains that it doesn't have the context based on the embedding. However, if I had run this directly on the terminal to the Ollama, that is Ollama run llama 3 and ask the question, why is sky blue? I would have gotten a very detailed answer. But here it is not giving me the answer because this is a RAG that is running to a very specific question. So I can ask a relevant question. Do you have a video on Swift? If yes, share me the details with links. I do have some videos on Swift and you can see that it is giving me the links and the description of those videos as well. I have really dumbed down the implementation of this particular RAG. Looking at it, you may feel that implementation of the RAG is pretty easy. If this is what it is going to take to write a simple RAG, it looks very easy because it's being run locally and the amount of data that we are dealing with is very, very small. In a real world production scenario, it will be very huge. You may have to most likely host it on cloud server, make it accessible with huge amount of data. There will be concurrency. So a lot of other things will definitely come into picture. But this was just a very basic introduction of how I implemented a simple RAG on a locally running machine using the Ollama. So do let me know how did you find this particular content, and that's it in this particular video. Thanks.
That brings us to the end of this particular video. Don't forget to like, comment, share the video and subscribe to the channel. Take care. Bye.